My title, John, gave me is glycemic response and index and load for weight management. So what I will do is give some thoughts about it. Becoming older, on one hand, you become a little bit more milder, but on the other hand, you also can do some more bold statements because you are not anymore that directly in the field. So let's see. So this is my disclosure. Nothing receive any financial support related to the program. I have some connections with pharma and especially also to food industry, especially donating food products for the intervention studies we do, some speaker honoraria and things like that. And related to this presentation, all of the results were published in peer-reviewed journals. Can I have it also on that screen? So let's start with some physiological arguments why glycemic index is of importance related to body weight management, and especially low glycemic index. So, and this type of research was done already, let's say 20 years ago, most of it. And I will give you just a couple of examples. First of all, increase in insulin sensitivity and also free fatty acid levels by minimizing glucose fluctuation over the day. And this is an example from Bente Keens from Copenhagen, which gives you very nice that with a high glycemic index, you give these high rise in glucose. And what is more important, I think, is that it also gives a shutdown of fatty acid oxidation. And that is maybe the most important part related to body weight management. Second is, of course, increase in 24-hour oxidation. And this is an example from Fabrio in 2000, showing very clearly over 24 hours that you can get with a low glycemic index diet over that day, you get an increase in fat oxidation and a decrease in glucose and especially glycogen oxidation, which is of importance for long-term weight management because we know that obese subjects has an impact fat oxidation. And then the next one is of course a very important one, increase satiety and lower food intake, and this is from the group of Jenny, already done in 95, showing clearly that with a low glycemic diet, you have an increase in satiety over the day, but what is more important, you see also a decrease in energy intake during, and this is, I think it was a couple of hours later, if I remember well, from the paper. But a lot of other papers also showed that with low glycemic food, you have a higher satiety and therefore lower food intake. And then finally, there is also the argument, some people say that you have an increase in diet-induced thermogenesis. And we did a study long time ago, and we didn't show any difference in relation to starch in this respect compared to glucose, fructose, or sucrose. So I don't think that is a very important factor related to physiology and weight management. But the big question is, of course, does it work in real life? And that means that you can see a lot of data in the literature where short-term, and I like the paper from Anna Raben, who reviewed in 2002 most of the studies at that time. And you can see there are a lot of short-term studies up to 1-2 weeks. And there are longer-term studies up to half a year, 6 months. And then we have some prospective epidemiological studies. And what you can see here, and I will not go in detail, that 50% say yes, there is a positive effect, and 50% say no, there is no effect. But there are a number of problems with these type of studies. For instance, there are a number of isoenergetic studies, and I don't think these are the best studies to do if you want to look at body weight regulation on the long term. I think the only one which really holds value for evaluation is the ad libitum studies, because that is what happened in real life. And also, in the energy restriction studies, there the purpose is to lose weight. So this is not really weight control, weight management on the long term, in respect to see what is going on. So the question is, how valid are these type of studies? I think if you talk about weight management, you should have at least studies of minimal 3 to 6 months, and preferable 6 months to a year. And if you talk about daily life, you have to do it in ad libitum situation, because all the other ones are more or less restricted, and of course you have an effect on energy intake, and therefore you have also an effect on body weight, but that is not what you like to look when you advise people to have a low glycemic diet or not. And finally, and now comes the bold statement, should we not abandon food intake data as a result, especially when it comes from unhealthy items like fat and sugary foods? I'm a believer that we should abandon all this type of questionnaires on food intake, because we cannot trust people anymore what they are saying, because they know now for 50 years exactly what they have to say about what is healthy and unhealthy. And I like this slide from Livesey, where they did an analysis of, I think, 60, 70 studies. And he also tabulated the studies on type of studies. And here you can see the ad libitum food intake. And this is going this way, is a lower glycemic index. And here you see the difference in energy intake. And you see clearly that with ad libitum food intake, there is an effect of low glycemic food, what you expect also based on the physiological data. If you have controlled food intake, there is no difference in energy intake. So again, this is a good example that for measuring or for looking into the effect of glycemic index in the real daily life situation, you have to do it with ad libitum food studies. Prospective studies and food intake data, but I said before, what and who should we believe? And I think I recommend you to read this paper. It's from the Energy Measurement Working Group, and especially David Ellison was the initiator of this. And the title is Energy Balance Measurement When Something Is Not Better Than Nothing. And in fact, it's a good argument why we should not ask people what they are eating and what is the energy intake, but we really should do measurements in order to get better effects and better objective measurements of food intake. And of course, I know it's very difficult, but we have to focus in this respect, because food intake data is becoming more and more unreliable. So the alternatives are measuring biomarkers of food intake and energy expenditure, and the double layer of water is a good example. Controlled intervention trials using new technologies like the supermarket model I will show you. And I think we should focus much more on food production data corrected for waste, because that type of data, especially when we are interested in trends, I think these data is much more reliable than looking in NHANES and see what people are saying what they eat. Diet and body weight management in general. I like this paper published beginning of this year, or end of last year, in JAMA, where they compare different weight loss or healthy diet program in overweight and obese adults. It was a meta-analysis, and there was an editorial which says, in fact, the conclusion of this meta-analysis, a diet by any other names is still about energy, and that is where it goes about. So we have to focus on energy and whether or not glycemic index will have an effect on that, because this meta-analysis showed clearly that from all these different diets that they analyzed, the studies published about that, that the Atkins diets with a very high fat diet and the Ornish diets with a very low fat diet were the most successful one. So micronutrient is not of importance, it's only about energy. And that means that we have to look how micronutrients can link to energy intake under an ad lib situation. And I think we should start with that, and in fact yesterday it was also said already, that we should start with fat, because it is a high density type of micronutrient. And we have now a number of studies and meta-analysis, and this is one of them we did with Arne Astrup, showing very clearly that, again, in an ad lib situation, ask people to eat less fat, they lose weight, and in this case it is about 2.8 kilograms. Voluntarily, not asking people this is a weight loss program, no, just saying we are focusing on fat in relation to cardiovascular health or whatever, and automatically they voluntarily also lose some weight, 3 kilograms. So the next question is then, if you lower energy coming from fat, then of course intake from carbohydrates goes up, and what type of carbohydrates are of importance? And this was in fact the start of the Carmen study we did in Europe end of the 90s. It was a European Commission funded study in 5 centers all over Europe, and this was a long-term multi-center randomized control parallel comparison of 400 overweight to obese subjects to study the effect of an ad libitum, and this is an important ad libitum reduction of 10% of fat intake. And we didn't focus at all at weight and say that this diet was more related to cardiovascular health and things like that. And at the same time we said, okay, we also look for the carbohydrate quality, and in that respect we didn't talk about low or high glycemic index. Sorry, Jenny and David. At that time, I was not a believer of the glycemic index. That was on one side. The other side was that it was very difficult at that time to look for in food tables which was a low or a high glycemic food. And because we did it in a controlled situation in the supermarket, we needed to have clear information about glycemic index, and therefore we use, which is well known tabulated in food tables, the simple or complex carbohydrates, which is maybe, I'm not sure, but I think it's a good proxy also for low and high glycemic food. And here you see some of the examples. We started in that study for the first time, and we did already some before in Maastricht, where you provide all the food to subjects for 6 months, and you provide, say, you only can shop in this shelf, which is low fat type of products compared to the similar type of products which is normal fat or simple carbohydrates or complex carbohydrates. And you can see on the bottom also that we did for the Diogenes study, which I will show later, we did that for the whole family, and we barcode everything. So this is a very controlled, semi-controlled way, because they are still able to go their own to the supermarkets to buy their own favorites and alcohol, of course. But at least you push them in a certain direction of low glycemic or high glycemic food. It's also quite complex, and I admire now more supervisors of supermarkets, because it's a hell of a job to get things on time and fresh in particular. So this was the outcome, and you see clearly you have the SCHO, that's the simple carbohydrate group, and the complex carbohydrate group, and the control group, and you see that if you look to the fat mass, there is a decrease in fat mass of about 1.4 to nearly 2 kilograms in both groups with a lower fat intake, because they had a decrease of 10% coming from fat. And in one case it went up with the simple carbohydrate, and the other case it went up with the complex carbohydrate. But in both cases they lose significantly more body weight and body fat compared to the control group. There were no significant difference between the simple and complex, although there was a tendency that the complex was losing more weight than the simple. But I think the 400 people were not enough to make it statistically significant. Now, based on that, a couple of years after, I was thinking about, okay, we now know that fat is of importance. We have an idea about carbohydrate type, more in the direction of unrefined or low glycemic versus high glycemic. And at that time, also protein came into the picture as an important factor. So that was, for me, the idea to start a new European project, which was the Diogenes project. And in this case, we focused on low fat intake, still low fat intake, but then increase a little bit more in protein or in low glycemic food. And with the help of Jenny in particular, because it was still a hell of a job to rank all the breads all over Europe related to glycemic index, but she helps us very much in that respect to make it possible. And you can see that we use a model which we are used already for 20 years in Maastricht, that we people lose weight, and then we randomize them into different groups and see what is the weight regain, because this is a period of that people are very vulnerable for gaining weight. And of course, it's not exactly the same like weight gain in a long-term situation, but then you have to wait for 1-2 years, and that is impossible to do this type of studies. For this is in the weight regain phase, after they lost about 11 kilograms of body weight, the whole group, and in this way you can see that you are able to look in the period time window of about 6 months to see what is the weight doing with the high protein, low protein, or high glycemic, low glycemic. And the outcome, you know, this was published a couple of years ago. You can see clearly that the high protein, low glycemic group is the one who really kept off all the weight, so the 11 kilograms over the 6 months period. And you can see that the increase in protein was about 5 energy percent, which is not that much. So you can do that in a normal situation. And also the reduction in glycemic index was about 5 units, which is again not a very dramatic change in diet if you want to have a more lower glycemic food. We also look in 2 centers, Copenhagen and Maastricht, the outcome after 1 year. All the people in that 2 centers, because they used also the supermarket system. And we saw after 1 year that the protein effect was still significant, but the low glycemic index effect was disappeared. At least it was not longer significant. And of course, the number of people were smaller, was about 120 people. But it also gives an idea that if you talk about influence of macronutrients, I think both have an effect, most probably protein a little bit more than the glycemic index, low glycemic index. Now, what has happened in the last 10 years related to meta-analysis, because we are now depending completely on meta-analysis to make conclusions out of things. There are now 2 available. There was the Cochrane review from Thomas Elliott and Bauer, which was in 2007. And there was one published a little bit more than 1 year ago by Hoffman, Swings, Haki, and Hoffman. And you can see in the first one, there were 6 randomized controlled trials included from 5 weeks to 6 months, which, to my opinion, is not very valid to do that, especially the shorter ones. And there were only 3 randomized controlled trials at lip, low versus high, and another one at lip, low versus energy restricted. So in fact, you can throw away this one, because this is not really something to look at if you want to have an effect of glycemic index in the daily life situation. And again, the other one, the systematic review from 2013, there were about 2,500 subjects involved. This was from half a year up to 1.5 years, so that looks a little bit more better. And there were 5 randomized controlled trials at lip, low versus high, and also 2 about low versus high glycemic load. Now, the outcome in the forest plot, I don't think you can see it very well in the back, but at least what is of importance, that in the first one from 2007, there was about 1 kilogram lowering body weight with a low glycemic index, and in the latest analysis you see it was 0.6 kilogram body weight, which sounds to me logic if you look the results from the Diogenet project, that it has an effect, but it is at least certainly smaller than for fat, and maybe also a little bit smaller than for protein. Now, this is my last slide, and I adapted this from Dave Mila, who is using that already for a couple of years, showing what are the important issues related to diet in relation to body weight management. And of course, there are a number of factors which we didn't talk about today, but I think, and I also adapted a little bit to my own experience and ideas, energy content and portion size are the most important ones. And energy content is directly related to fat content. So despite the fact that a lot of people are saying fat is not of importance, it is sugar in the diet, I don't believe them. It is still fat who makes the difference, especially in relation to ad libitum, in the real life situation related to body weight gain. Then volume, especially on viscosity, solid versus liquid, we didn't talk about that. Then I think protein intake is of importance. Glycemic index is coming up, and then carbohydrate type and fat type, I don't think it is really of importance related to body weight regulation on the long term. Thank you for your attention.